Okay, good evening and welcome to the March 4, 2013 meeting of the BUHS District 6 Board. We are starting a few minutes late as the BAMS committee had important deliberations to finish, and but we'll get moving through the agenda, and we'll start with the clerk's report. And the first item is approval of the minutes. We have two meetings for minutes approval, and we start with the special meeting on January 30th. Is there a motion?
I move the minutes of January 30th as presented.
Okay, Ricky, and
second
by Lori. Okay. Are there any additions, deletions, or corrections? I believe those minutes were circulated a while ago. If not, all in favor of approving the minutes of the special meeting January 30th, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any negatives? Any abstentions? Lori and Ian were not there. Okay, then we move on to the regular meeting, February 4th. Is there a motion?
I move approval of the minutes of the February 4th, 2013 meeting.
Okay, second by Ricky. Are there any additions, corrections, deletions? If not, all in favor of approving the minutes of the regular meeting on February 4th, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions on that one?
Yeah.
Gone, okay. All right. Any communications? No, I have none. Anything else for the clerk's report? Okay, we will move on to recognition of groups or individual visitors. Seeing none, I guess we'll move past that and request a motion to go into consent agenda.
I move we go into consent agenda.
Second by Russ, and did you get the second?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Opposed or abstentions? Okay, we are in consent agenda, and we'll start with finance.
Okay, finance met on February 6th, 2013, and approved warrants 1140, 1141, 1142, 1143, 1144, 1145. 1146, 1147, and 1148 for a total of $473,938.08. And we also approved payrolls for January 11th in the amount of $485,376.33, and for January 25th, a payroll in the amount of $499,510.35. And the rest of our time at that meeting was taken up with discussing the budget for the annual meeting. And Mr. Woodworth will have to talk about the February 18th meeting because I was ill.
That actually was to be a February 20th meeting.
Yeah.
And there were just two of us there, so we did not have a quorum. So the warrants that are listed on tonight's agenda for February 18th still have to be reviewed by the Finance Committee, which will meet this Wednesday at 7 a.m. So we're only approving consent agenda for the February 4th warrants and payroll, the 2 weeks of payroll. Is that correct, Ruth?
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. And it's a rare thing for Ruth to not feel well enough to show up at a 7 a.m. meeting, so we're glad you're back in full operation.
I hope.
Okay. Planning and policy.
That has not met since our last meeting.
Okay. Teacher curriculum.
Yeah, we met earlier this evening. We spent most of the time talking about grading policies and procedures and talking with the administration about some grading, how the grading process is done and how the procedures work and those kinds of things, and I guess we're getting some questions answered. So it was good. It was a good meeting.
And that's grading, G-R-A-D-I-N-G.
Yes.
not with a T.
No T.
Okay. Sorry. Moving on to BAMS committee.
BAMS committee did meet earlier this evening. We spent time talking about some personnel issues and about a student matter that we're going to need to do an executive session about later on.
Okay. Do it at the end of the meeting.
Yep.
Okay. Career Center, we met on the 28th, and our primary topic was reviewing the marketing program that is being developed. We saw some advertising that's out there, some great testimonials, and we feel that that's going to be a real plus towards recruiting, particularly in the sending town areas. So we got to see that, and we reviewed the census for this semester, which is fairly strong overall, up a little bit. I don't remember what the numbers were.
Up about
5%, which is a good thing. So we're getting the census, student census back up a little bit. So that was the basis of our 28th meeting. Is there anything else for consent agenda?
What's 5%? How many students?
How many, what does that represent?
Trying to remember. About 27, I think.
28. Okay, yeah. You can't tell with 5%.
Yeah.
Okay, is there a motion to approve consent?
I move approve consent agenda.
Really? Is that you, Sean? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay. Consent agenda is approved. We'll move on to administrative reports. We might as well start at the south end.
Well, that would be me.
Yeah, they know their directions. South end of the building and south end of the table. BAMS.
February 4th, we had our social justice assembly. This has become a wonderful whole school, multimedia assembly that we focus on social justice or equality and fairness and respect for all of our differences. This year, student leadership really took a stand in helping. We had one of our student leadership council members that actually was the MC of the presentation or of the assembly. The assembly really focuses on, they have a lot of video clips that we bring in that the students help to find that are YouTube kind of video clips on racism, on gay-straight issues. Not so much this year, but in the last year, we did a couple of the PSAs that are around, you know, stop saying the R word or, you know, the R word is in special ed terms. Okay, I don't want to say it.
If not, go to the assembly next year.
That's right. This year, we also had BOHS Gay Straight Alliance as presenters, and they came and there were four of the students that talked to our students very briefly. They each had about a 30-second to a minute spot. We didn't, you know, time them. But they really talked about what middle school was like for them as they were questioning their own sexuality and as they grow, get older, what it's like for them and in high school in terms of their acceptance levels and how they've been able to accept themselves. The Student Leadership Council also did a whole school activity during this time. It's called Stand Up, and so it was, they asked the student body who's sitting, stand up if this is true about you. And so they'd have asked questions like, stand up if you've ever made fun of anyone. And so you'd have, you know, various people stand up, that sit down. Stand up if anyone has ever made fun of you. And so this is audience participation activity. When the assembly was finished, it was about a 45-minute assembly. Then we asked all students to return to their advisories, where each advisory was asked to come together in a structure called Circle of Power and Respect. They're all sitting in a circle with their advisor. It's a developmental design strategy around making, it's really focusing on this idea about having everyone belong in a circle and advisory, feeling that everybody's voice is heard and respected. And so in that circle of power and respect that afternoon, we gave each advisory some questions to help guide their discussion around the topic of social justice and respect and acceptance for all.
Thank you.
It went very, very well.
It was Circle of Power, is that what it is?
Called Circle of Power and Respect. It comes out of the developmental designs strategy. Also, elementary schools refer to it as responsive classroom. But at the middle level, it's called developmental designs. So some of our teachers went to a training last summer on developmental designs. So really at BAMS, this is another offshoot, but at BAMS, we're not only incorporating positive behavioral intervention supports or PBIS strategies in working with students in our student body, but also now developmental design specifically in our advisory time.
Thank you. Anything else from?
I'll make this very quick. Unfortunately, we ran out of time with the BAMS committee, and I wanted to apprise the BAMS committee of the Green Mountain Star process that we've been working through since the beginning of the school year. We had 12 meetings so far around this topic of Green Mountain Star. It's a restructuring process that we are required to follow by the Agency of Education. It used to be Department of Ed in our state. Now it's the Agency of Education. And in these 12 meetings, which have been either committee meetings or whole faculty meetings, we have been asked to work with 57 unique individual indicators. Obviously, I'm not going to read this document to you. An example of an indicator, all teachers are guided by a document that aligns Common Core standards, curriculum, instruction, and assessment. Or the leadership team uses multiple measures, academic, behavior, student health, to make decisions about student learning, for example. Those are two of the 57 indicators we were asked to assess as a whole faculty. We did that process. We assessed them. We put ourselves on a path of the most significant in our building to the least significant. From that, we selected six indicators of the 57 from which we developed a plan, our action plan for next school year. In addition to the six we selected, the state gave us six more. They call the restructuring indicators. So we picked everything at the top. You can't read it, of course. The state gave us below the line. We then had to create a plan that incorporated these 12 indicators into it. We have a three-page plan. It's still in draft stage. It will continue to work its way. Here's an example of the first goal. Through the use of a common driving document, and that's what we call our curriculum maps, effective pedagogy, that's instructional strategies, and data analysis, student achievement will increase for all demographic groups in the school. So that being the goal, we then identified four tasks related to that goal that we will follow to achieve that goal next year. A second goal We will create a school community council that strengthens the bonds between schools and families in order to increase the achievement of all students. The last goal. It is our goal to strengthen our tiered system of supports within the core classroom instruction and within additional support classes. Staff members will increase their expertise related to the use of formative assessment and data-driven instruction. All students, including those with diverse ethnic, learning, and socioeconomic backgrounds, will show an increase in their proficiency in math and literacy. The BAM's leadership team will develop a system that prioritizes services based on which learners are at greatest risk and help teachers adjust to and understand the need for data-based decision-making. It's a mouthful, I know, but we took those three goals that I just read out loud. From it, we identified a series of tasks. Altogether, there's 12 tasks that we've put ourselves on this path of addressing for next school year. Our plan has to be completed by May 31st, entered into the software, the state level software. It then gets approved by our coordinator at the state level. So we're well on our way to meeting the goal of identifying our plan, and we've already got a draft in the software, but we meet this Thursday morning to review it once again. I'm hoping that we'll be very close to finalizing this. And then this really becomes our roadmap for next school year. This plan is what drives our decisions as a school, both for training for teachers, professional development, as well as instruction for students. So, as I say, we've been working on this since October 4th, our very first meeting, and our next meeting is March 7th, this Thursday morning. That will be the 12th meeting on this process this year.
I guess maybe I should have heard of this before, but it's the first time I've heard this. Is this selected schools were picked to do this, or is this, or middle schools, or?
That's a good question, Woody. It's close to 73% of the schools in the state. Those who didn't make AYP on the NECAP are now being asked to work with Green Mountain Star. The state bought a 5-year subscription. It's a national organization called Indistar, and the state subscribed to this program for 5 years. Each school which did not make AYP, depending on whether it's year one or year two or year three, has to work through this process of assessing the indicators. In our case, it was 57 indicators. And then from that, identifying those that will become part of our plan. So many, many schools in the state and most schools in our district are now doing this. Elementary, middle, and high school is not because of your NEAS.
Right, just for NEAS.
Yeah.
Because of the NEAS process?
Oh, okay.
But I would probably anticipate that next year we'll be doing it.
And Interstar is a consultant to the state?
It is. National. Yeah. Educational, national. And they have hundreds of indicators, if not into the thousands. Actually, some of these indicators have a 4-digit number, meaning the number of indicator it is. Our state selected the indicators from the whole batch, the ones that they wanted us as a state to focus on.
Yeah, well, I'm looking at the website now. They have 168 indicators.
Uh-huh.
Do you think this is going to work?
It seems rather onerous.
Well, we whittled it down to six. We chose six. We were then told there were six more.
I mean, just briefly going through this, it's unbelievable. I mean, you're going to spend more time on this than teaching students.
We spent a lot of time on it.
But you'll have a web page if anybody's interested.
Yeah.
Well, that's I guess I was, what I was wondering is if there's so much time involved in all this meeting and reporting and adding up numbers as opposed to FaceTime the students.
Yeah.
I mean, I know you're going to find a way to get it done.
Yeah, and we are. You know, I have felt from the beginning the value of this for us has been in the conversations that we've had, the professional conversations as a faculty. With the exception of two of the 12 meetings, the meetings have been outside of the student day. Two of the meetings happened during the student day, but the other 10 outside of the student day. But there's been a lot of very valuable conversation that's occurred at the whole faculty level, at the best team level, at the data team level. Jerry and I each participate in those committees, at the action plan committee meeting, at our leadership council team level. So at many levels of the school, there have been really good conversations.
Sure. If I could make a comment, I mean, making adequate yearly progress would be the ideal, but the whole process that you're now going through, if you've made adequate yearly progress, you would not have the benefit for what you're actually doing.
You're absolutely right about that.
Lemons and lemonade. Yeah.
Well, and if AYP was based on incremental improvement over time, we would have been golden a long time ago. You know, because our school has continued to show an upward trajectory of achievement by our students. But it's not based on that. You know, it's based on this calculated summative number that either you make it or you don't. And then it feels very punitive, even though kids are making progress. And we can demonstrate that our kids are making significant progress each year. But, Sean, you're absolutely right. I mean, the conversations have been very enriching. The teachers have told us that. They've enjoyed the conversation. So it's not a bad thing.
What was that website?
Green Mountain Star.
Oh, it's like that. They have their
Green Mountain Department of Education. Okay. I just Googled Green Mountain Star, and it comes up with a guidance handbook for navigating the Green Mountain Star system.
Yeah, yeah. Mm.
Could we get a copy of the plan when it's complete?
Yes, definitely. Yeah, we're very close to finishing it. Yeah.
Okay. That it for BAMS?
Yeah.
Okay, we'll move north.
All the way north or just
not all the way north?
Further.
So I actually have several things and quite a few personnel things to talk about along the way. First of all, I'd like to acknowledge that we did have our play Gypsy run for 3 days right before break. Performances were very well received, and as usual, Steve Rice and Bob Kramsky and Mitch Davis did a great job, and the kids were stellar. They really brought the play to life, especially the main characters of Gypsy Rose and her mother. Really well done. We are... Speaking of action planning, we are going to be doing our action planning for next year with our department heads on May 1st. And I would like to ask for a board member that could participate in that every year. A board member does. We meet from 10:15 to 1:45 this year. So if somebody wants to think about that time frame.
What was the date again?
May 1st. And I don't need an answer right now. I'm just putting that out there. 10:15 to 1:45. And we actually, now with NEASC, we do our action planning and we do it through the lens of our school's core values. And with the NEASC, I want to thank Ian specifically for his service to the Core Value and Learning Expectation Group. They met last Thursday to approve their committee report. So that's four committee reports that the faculty has approved, and there's three more coming, and then when that report's all our self-study's done, I'll give everybody on the board a copy of that to see. But that process is going along really well. Doug Kroc and Rick Lane are chairing the NEAS committee together, and they're doing a phenomenal job of keeping the entire faculty moving along. So we're very grateful to have them. this Wednesday, in our auditorium, we're having a special parent scheduling meeting, and that is for every parents of students who are in 8th grade through 11th grade. And the intention of that is to give parents a chance to come to the high school in all of those grades to meet with counselors to talk about what a four-year plan looks like, what a four-year plan is, to learn about programs at the high school, to learn about the collegiate high school, and also to learn about career center programming. And we figure that will be about an hour and a half program. Next year, we plan to, in some way, combine that with our eighth grade parent night. But we're very excited about that. We think it's going to be a great night for a lot of people. Next Thursday, the 14th, we have our parent conferences, and we'll be releasing school at 12:30 for that. And parent conferences will be from 3 until 7. Teachers are at various places around the school, either in their classroom or in the gymnasium. Parents can come and talk about their students' progress. And that generally gets really busy around 5. Between 5 and 7 gets really busy. So I'd encourage people to get there early if they can. The other thing we're going to try this spring is something called ACE period. And I think Lachlan talked about it with the board earlier. And I'd like to just kind of go through this a little bit. And I wish I could say it was an original idea, but several schools in the area are trying a support period within the school day. And what we're going to try is on Tuesdays and Thursdays, we're going to shave a few minutes off of each of the blocks and then have a period of time from 10:10 to 10:40 for students to actually get help from a teacher. So teachers will call a student back. So if a student, say if I was a science teacher, which isn't much of a stretch, I could call a student back to complete a lab, finish a quiz, make up a test, whatever they need to do during that period of time. Many schools have started to do this because, as we all know, student lives and family lives are getting more complex. It's really hard now for all of our students to remain after school to meet with a teacher. So we're trying to find a way to do that meeting time during the school day. Most schools that do this do it for 5 days a week. We're going to try it for 2. We're going to pilot it this spring. And then we're going to ask students and teachers what they think. Do they like the idea? Should we keep doing it? But we thought we would try it this year and see how it works. What I've given you is the ACE period questions and answers. That's a document that we're asking our teachers to review with their advisories on Wednesday. On Thursday, I'll be going on to DHS TV to talk about it some more. Some basic questions about how it's structured. And then on the last page, you can see that's our proposed schedule for Tuesdays and Thursdays. So, we're excited to try it. We've been talking about it for about a year. We polled the faculty in early January after talking about it again, and about 80% of the faculty want to give it a try. And so we're going to try it and see what we need to do. Hopefully it's going to help students. As the board knows, we're always looking for ways to help students either be more successful in their classes, and in some cases to avoid having students leave school. So.
A good question. I just kind of glanced at this really quickly, but what if a student A doesn't think they need help or chooses not to use that time? Does that just give them 30 minutes to be roaming?
It doesn't. What they're going to do is go back to their advisory. So,
if their advisory is teacher needs to be meeting with
their advisory, right? That's one of the things we've talked about with our advisories with teachers, and that's one of the challenges is that we're hoping this gets used extensively. So what will happen is those teachers will write a pass for however many students they need to call back. We're actually using a Google Doc so teachers can track which students have been called back when. So they can actually see, like Ricky got called back by Ms. Crisco on this Tuesday, so I'm going to have to call him back on Thursday. So we kind of help teachers begin to schedule kids for help. For those students that don't get called back, they do remain in their advisory for a quiet study for 30 minutes. And if I had to pick one thing that was the challenge, it would be that. But we're going to work through it. We're going to try it and see how it works. What a lot of schools do is they actually meet 5 days a week. And on Mondays, they meet with their advisor. And their advisor actually goes through and assigns where they're going to go every day that week. I'd love to get there, but I think what I want to do is try it and see how the concept of help within a school day flies with staff and with students. before we jump into a five-day a week program. So I guess on to some personnel issues.
Just before we move to that, before I forget it and don't bring it up later, on the May 1st meeting, is there someone who has a burning desire to attend that?
I can do that.
Would you have more than one?
Sure.
Okay, because I think I would like to try to get to it too, so we can.
Thank you.
You'll give us some details as to
Absolutely.
Where.
Yep, we'll get closer.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Sorry.
That's okay.
Just wanted to get that out of the way while I was thinking about it. But we can move on to you. You have several.
Right.
Resignations.
As we all know, the board has offered a retirement incentive for staff this year. And several staff members have taken it. And what I'd like to do is kind of go through these staff members and ask the board to accept their resignations. I'm not going to read all of their letters. Woody has copies of their letters if you want to see them. I have copies you can see as well. The first one is Cheryl Liberdoni from Physical Education. Has written a very nice letter. She references her children and herself growing up here in Brattleboro. And we're sad to lose Cheryl, but she has submitted her intention to retire at the end of this year. Do you want to do a motion on each one?
Yeah, why don't we do it as each individual one,
okay.
In case there's questions
sure.
or
yep.
whatever. So is there a motion to accept the retirement request of Cheryl Liberdoni?
I move that we accept the retirement request for Cheryl Liberdoni as presented.
With regret.
Is that a second as well? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed or abstentions? Okay. And accepted with regret the retirement request for Cheryl Liberdoni.
The second one is a teacher who's been at the high school for 27 years. And after 27 years at BUHS and 39 years of teaching, Tim Kipp has elected to retire this year. And so after a long service to the socialized department and to the community, he will be stepping down. I think we can all point to many things that Tim has done to help our district move ahead.
Including writing his request letter in the form of a poem.
I'm not going to read this poem out loud.
No, I didn't want you to do that.
Thank you. That was sort of shared.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept with regret the resignation of Tim Kipp, longtime social studies teacher.
I'll second that.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay. Next.
The next is from our English department. Susan Boardman has elected to also retire this year, at the end of this school year. She's taught AP and other English courses for a long time, and she'll be difficult to replace.
And she did not write a poem.
You know, you would think she would.
You probably would have been from my English.
Right.
Is there a motion?
I move to accept with regret the request to retire by Susan Boardman.
Okay, second?
Second.
Okay. One of those two, I don't know who.
I'll give it to Sean.
Give it to Sean, yeah. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay, we've accepted the retirement request of Sue Boardman.
Also in the English department chair Nancy Olson, after many years, 36 years in Wyndham Southeast Supervisory Union, 35 at the high school, Nancy Olson has elected to retire as well.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
I move to accept with regret the resignation of Nancy Olson from the English department.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay.
Also, another department head, Modern Classical Language, Judy Abascal. 28 years in Wyndham Southeast Supervisory Union, 41-year teaching career. Judy has done incredible things, both as a classroom teacher and as department head. She has nurtured and helped grow BUHS Abroad, and now it's a yearly event to various countries. She's inspired many students through her work to pursue careers where they use foreign language and classical languages. Losing Judy is going to be a difficult blow for us. She's been an amazing teacher and an amazing advocate for kids for many years.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept with regret the resignation of Ms. Judy Abascal from the Foreign Language Department.
Seconded by Sean. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay. One more.
Probably one of the most difficult ones is 25 years ago, we had a school counselor come here to fill a one-year maternity position. That counselor never left and has been here ever since. And Bill Jan has had an incredible impact on many, many students in the community. He has been a calm and reasoned voice on the faculty for many years. He's a person that I personally look to as a friend and also as somebody that I can bounce any idea off of and get an honest answer. And along with Paul Cullen, whom we approved last week, Bill is leaving now, but he will certainly be remembered here for a long time. So I would ask the board to accept his resignation.
I move we accept the resignation of Bill Jan from the counseling department with regret.
Okay, second?
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay.
So that said, one thing that we have posted some of these positions. We're using SchoolSpring, which is an online service, and we've had great success with that. I will be asking the board members to serve on various hiring committees as we move ahead. And with the board's permission, I'll funnel those requests and dates through the chair. He can talk to people, but I certainly am eager to work with the candidates and with the board and faculty members to get good people in these positions.
That's going to be a lot of work, and we'll need help from everyone in one fashion or another. That's a pretty big bite.
Yeah, I would just like to say that, I mean, everybody knew that one day, this day, was the evening was going to arrive. Since all of these teachers actually taught both my kids when they were here. It's a sad day. Sad day.
Well, it's time marches on and people march on, and they've been a tremendous, tremendous group for the school. And but as you said, there's always a time when it comes to move on, and we'll need to find some replacement. A lot of institutional memory and other memories that go along with this, and we'll miss them all. But we'll move ahead. Okay.
The last item. Sorry.
You're done. I'm
talking longer than you. last year, the board granted a leave request to a special educator named Henry Juni Pereira, and with an option to request a second year of leave. Dr. Staley received a letter on earlier in January requesting that, and so I would ask the board to extend Juni Pereira his leave of absence to 2 years, so he can also have the 2013-2000 school year on leave.
Extended to a two-year leave.
Yes, he's on leave now.
2 years.
He's asking to extend it.
Okay.
For next
just so
year
we're
well.
Clear, it's not
yes.
Extending it 2 years.
Right.
It's
one more year.
One more year.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'll move the request.
Okay. And I'll second it.
Okay. Move to second it. Okay. Any questions on that? Discussion? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
Let the record show.
Okay, well, that's quite a bit of business right there. We'll move on to the Career Center.
I'm not in a contest to make it longer. I'd like to start with, we're announcing the community education, adult education courses for the spring semester. They basically start next week. Here's a list of those classes. Please feel free to use them if you'd like. We'll take advantage of our online offerings. And then very significant is our dance students are going to the high school dance festival, which they do every year, this time in Newport, Virginia. And they will be leaving Thursday and returning Sunday. And they usually come back with an armful of scholarships and opportunities for summer workshops that they get to go to. So for the dancing, the dancers, it's quite a show. Thank you.
That it?
That's it.
I didn't look through this all the way, but is there a course on interviewing skills that maybe we should all
I'll bet
sign up for?
I bet on the online courses there is.
Yeah. That's a sharpening. Okay. Central office is not here. Board chair report. I have just one item, and this is wearing another one of my hats for the Governor's Institute, and we are in recruiting mode for the Governor's Institute. Every year, Brattleboro has sent a large number of kids to the various institutes, and we've actually provided some tuition assistance. This year, we're beginning a tuition, sliding scale tuition, I guess is what we should call it. And so there's an opportunity for every kid that would like to go. I believe that the counselors, Liz DeNord kind of heads it up here at the school. The counselors have made information available. I have some cards here. If you know a youngster that goes to school here that you think would benefit from one of these institutes, and I can speak from personal experience with a son who benefited tremendously from Governor's Institute, and I think it's a great opportunity. The institutes are held at various parts around Vermont. Some are at UVM. The one on current issues and youth activism is right here at World Learning, and just a great opportunity. So if you think of a youngster that might be interested, get the word out.
What is the timing as far as?
Well, I'm not sure when the recruiting period ends. There's posters around in the school, I believe, but the timing of the institutes. Arts, June 23rd, right after school gets out, basically. Arts, information technology, environmental science, which is at UVM. Arts is at Castleton, information tech at Champlain. Engineering then, same week at UVM. Asian cultures at UVM, and math at UVM, actually the week before. So it's pretty much right as when school gets out for those two-week period.
And it's for students who will be in grades 9 through 12?
Generally not 12th graders, because they're
will be
on.
In.
But
majority are 10 and 11th.
10 and 11th grade are the key.
Because it's during the summer, so it'll be.
And Sean's had a...
Yeah, both of my kids did.
Yeah.
My daughter did Castleton, the arts program, and it was amazing. My son did the UVM. Engineering.
Yes, right. Yeah, and life-changing. Even though it's only a week, or some of them are a little bit longer than that, but life-changing experience for kids.
Yeah, the kids live right on the campus,
right,
of the college, so they get a college campus experience. Right. And it's a sophomore. It's
And this is not necessarily geared towards kids that are the very, very top in that particular category, but it's kids that might be, we call it ignited, you know, that there's a spark there of interest. And once they go to these institutes, then that sets them on towards pursuing that particular area. So if there's any interest, I just wanted the board to be aware of it, too, that we are looking to send a good contingent from BUHS.
I have one question in the administrative reports, and that would be, and this is just personally, do you know when the playoffs are for the hockey?
5 o'clock tomorrow. Yeah, and then the next one is Friday, but I don't know what time. And if, assuming we win tomorrow, the Friday game will be home as well. Because we are the second seed in the state. So
wow.
having a phenomenal...
Friday at the same time?
I believe so. I'm not certain.
I thought the rink was closing.
It is. It's kept open extra.
Right.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So,
yeah, they're not going to have to go down to the meadows and shovel a playoff game. Okay. I believe that's it for administrative reports. And we'll move on to unfinished business. So we have some policy work to do.
Yes, we do.
Take it away, Ian.
All right. We have 6 policies that have come up. These are all for adoption. We've seen them all before. Policy F5, I'm going to make the motion on this, and then I would like to speak to the policy. So I move that we adopt policy F5, searches, seizures, and interrogation of students by law enforcement personnel or other non-school personnel.
Okay,
I'll second that.
Okay, and you'd like to speak.
All right, this is the one that we've talked about several times before. Just to sum up, the Planning and Policy Committee had some concerns with some of the wording in this policy. We discussed those concerns and ended up presenting our questions to the VSBA. The VSBA responded that they have, in fact, removed this policy from their recommended policies list. Citing some of our same concerns and essentially telling us in this email, and I have extra copies of this if anyone would like one for their records, that because this policy essentially summarizes existing law, it's better for schools to not have a policy and just go by the recent court rulings on that existing law rather than trying to go by policy that may not be up to date with current rulings. So I have presented this the same way as I present all other policies for, you know, standard procedure, but based on the recommendation from the VSBA, the Planning and Policy Committee recommends that we vote no on adoption of this policy.
Can I ask a question? A lot of our policies are based on state and federal law. What's different about this one that we don't? Because, I mean, part of a notion of having a policy book is that something happens and it's a quick reference. And if this happens, if the Steve or Ingrid or whoever say, you know, what do we do? I mean, you say call your lawyer and find out. I mean, we haven't gone through the policy in that detail to know what. But what's different about this one, Ben?
My understanding about what's different about this one is that there is currently a lot of litigation happening around this issue. So there are changes happening to the law and the way the law is interpreted.
And if I may, I believe what will happen is our current policy will remain our policy. So there won't be no policy or guidance. The current policy will be retained.
Well, that would be, we are not adopting the new policy. Their recommendation was actually that we do not have a policy, but that would be a separate issue whether we want to remove the existing policy.
No. If you want us to weigh in on this, we can.
It's good to have a policy. Mm.
What's the difference between the new policy and the existing policy?
Yeah. A lot.
Yeah. There were a number of differences, which essentially completely opened up the school to law enforcement if they wanted to question. All they had to do is say they're investigating the parents for something and could just come in and question students without any parental notification.
That's this one?
The new policy. The old policy did not have that clause.
The old policy leaves a lot of discretion to the administration.
To the administration, which we, as planning policy, felt is appropriate to essentially leave it up to the administration on a case-by-case basis how they're going to deal with the situation.
And that's working?
Yes. I'm a little confused between with F4 and F5. F4 is referred to in the letter.
Because our numbers got switched at the SU level.
Okay.
There was a clerical error, so our actual policies, the numbers are reversed from the state policies.
Okay. So in essence, they've removed their version of our F5.
Yes.
Okay. And some thoughts from...
Well, personally, I would like to retain the guidance of the current F5 right now. It's reasonable. It states clearly that we are not agents of law enforcement, that our children are protected. Parents know that we would be present should there be a need for an interrogation if parents themselves cannot be. I think it provides good guidance for us as school level administrators about our role and relationship with law enforcement.
What was the impetus where did it originate? Was this an SU policy?
The policy actually did come down the normal procedure from the DSBA. They have subsequent to presenting the new change in policy, changed their position on the policy.
But this one has been approved by the SU, at the SU level.
Yes, it has.
So it's already gone through the SU level. It's been approved at the SU level.
It went through the SU without anyone really questioning the broadening of the ability of law enforcement to come into the school and interrogate students. Yeah. And that was done, I think, in October, and we didn't get it until maybe November. And so the SU passed it, I think, I'm almost sure that the SU passed it without being aware that the VSBA had removed it from its selections of model policies.
Yeah, I certainly wasn't aware at the time that we voted on it that it had been that the VSBA had changed their position on it.
So if we vote no on this, then the current policy will stand.
We do not.
Okay,
we would
so your recommendation.
Adopt a new policy, and that is my recommendation.
Well, okay.
That we vote no.
All right. I've got it.
And just, Russ, one more answer to what you were asking. According to my communication from the VSBA, they are actually reviewing several other policies, so we may see more changes come down from them with things that they, in the future, say you don't really need a policy on this.
So, I mean, is their view that somehow we're opening ourselves up to something by applying the old policy, and that we should just say nothing? I mean, is that what the recommendation that is?
So the SU has this policy. We tell them that they shouldn't have this policy? Or?
Yes.
The representatives to the SU might want to pass that on. Right.
Yeah, and it's not beholden on us to follow every SU policy.
Next meeting's coming up pretty soon. Yeah, the SU.
Well, I think they can deal with that if they want. But in the meantime, if we have we're comfortable with the administrative recommendation that we maintain the old policy, then we can vote accordingly.
If I'm still on the SU board, I'll be happy to bring it to their attention.
That's right, we got to reorganize.
We have to reorganize ourselves next time around.
Okay, well, are there any other questions or comments, or are we ready for a vote? Okay.
Call the question.
I want to thank Ian and the other folks on the policy committee for
Further pursuing
questions and bringing this to our attention.
Okay, so remember how we're all those in favor. All those in favor.
I move to amend.
We got that was Russ. And
oh no, I'm sorry. If you're supposed to vote against it, so I'm not voting in favor of it. I'm just trying to find where the next SU is. I think it's on the 27th.
Okay. Opposed.
Nay.
Nay. Your abstention. Okay. That's rare that we all have a big no vote.
Opposition.
We should agree to most everything. Okay. So that's F5. Also known as F4 on a state level. Okay.
All right, the rest of the policies are simple. We've gone over these all and they're all good. So I moved to adopt policy E10, school crisis prevention and response.
Second. Okay. Any discussion on that one? Not all in favor?
Aye.
And vote yeses.
Okay.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay. E10 is approved.
All right. I move we adopt policy F4, searches, seizures, and interrogations of students by school personnel.
Second.
There's a question there. I have a note here that Ingrid, you had asked about whether cell phones were covered. Yeah. Did we ever get
that? I believe Ron answered that question.
Yes, did he?
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Mm-hmm.
Opposed or abstentions? Okay, we have adopted F4. Next.
I move we adopt policy F17, 18-year-old students.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion, questions? Not all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? It's adopted.
I move board adopt policy F18, age of attendance.
Second.
Okay, 50 seconds. Discussion? Just a twitch. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay, we have adopted F18. And last but not least,
I move to adopt policy G10, special education.
Second.
Okay, questions, comments? Not all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed or abstentions? Okay, we have adopted E10, F4, F17, F18, and G10, and not adopted F5. Okay. Is there anything else under unfinished business? Is there anything else under new business? I have just one item. Now that we've completed the budget season, which seems like it went on for quite a while, I'd like to see us get back to our once a month board education session. I'm wondering, I cannot personally remember where we left off last time amongst the three schools. Is there someone that has something in mind?
I have a student called Renew for Pizza. I'd like to have them come and speak to the board about what they're doing to help remove unexploded ordnance.
Yes, I read about that.
That would be great. See the board.
Yeah. So that would be at our next meeting, which is what day is it?
Second.
The 18th. Okay. Could you arrange that, and if you would, let assuming they can do it, let Barb know that. Okay.
That's not.
Is there?
That's not a day that there's no school, is it?
There's school.
Oh, okay. I don't know why. I'm not.
It's the day after St. Patrick's Day. It might be February.
Sorry, the 25th is an in-service day for teachers. March 25th. No school for kids.
Right.
That's just the week after.
Oh, the 25th. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. It was somewhere around there.
All right. Is there anything else under new business? If not, I believe we have a motion in order for executive session for student matters. For student matter, moved by Ricky. Second. Somebody second?
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
We will move into executive session. Okay. We dissolved the executive session. We're back in open session. Is there a motion?
Yes. I move that we approve the administration, the BAMS administration's recommendation on the student matter.
Second?
Second.
Okay, did you get that, Ruth? If you move or seconded. Okay, is there any discussion? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed or abstentions? None? It's unanimous. Okay, is there a motion to adjourn?
I move we adjourn.
Second. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Thank you all very much.